job, so you gotta read, but I'm gonna read something to you. And one is, starting on Tuesday, we're going to start looking at the bad girls of the Bible. Sounds like fun, doesn't it? That'll be on Tuesdays at noon in the Uptown Ministry Center. And then on Wednesday, there's a lunch and learn, and that will be Jan Bellar with the Southern Area on Aging. And the first topic is seeing how we can age in place at home. And it's a question we're all going to be involved with at some time. Whether you're a parent, a child, or a child of an adult parent, who knows, you're going to be involved with this kind of decision at some point. And the food bank is collecting fruit for the month of April. And the Rise Against Hunger initiative will be on the 28th at 9 o'clock. And I urge you to sign up. I believe there's probably a sign-up sheet outside the sanctuary. Sign up so that they'll know you're going to come to the party. So that you're going to feed a lot of people. All right. Shall we prepare our hearts and minds for worship?
Thank you.
continue in an attitude of prayer as we prepare to hear the scriptures read and expounded on. Holy and powerful God, as far as our comprehension is, as the grand design of your universe, we seek to know you through the poor vehicle of words and the presence of the Holy Spirit. As the scripture is read, may we go beyond hearing to doing. Grant that we may feel your presence, as did the followers who knew Jesus by touching his wounded hands. May we experience the fire within that sent them out to share the good news in word and deed. Amen. Our gospel lesson is from Luke chapter 24, verses 36 to 48. Now this follows the story of the walk to Emmaus. So the people that had been with Jesus on the walk to Emmaus had run back to Jerusalem and joined the disciples there. And so this is, Jesus is talking to the whole group. And it says, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified, and thought they were seeing a ghost. Jesus said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, Jesus said to them, "Have you anything to eat here?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. And he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses to all of these things." This is the word of God. Our hymn of preparation is number 273, Jesus' Hands for Common Hands. Ago, I had my knee replaced, so I've had to sit and ice and exercise. exercise and ice and walk around the block and ice. So I kind of want the time to think. My mind has been wandering all over the place. And it's kind of Lent and Easter, so that was kind of nice. It's a nice time in the church here. And for the last couple of weeks, I've been pondering on resurrection stories and knowing I was going to preach today. This one was, you know, right up there in the forefront of my brain. So I've been thinking about this gospel story. And one of the oddities of this resurrection story is the way Jesus identifies himself to his friends. Look at my hands and my feet, he says to his terrified, doubtful disciples. I think we can identify with the disciples here. This had never happened before, so they were scared to death. They are shaking in their sandals. They might have been wondering if this was a group hallucination. When he offers them four sure proofs that he is who they think he is. Two hands, two feet, 10 fingers, 10 toes, which could belong to no one but Jesus. It is the wounds he wants them to see. But isn't that a peculiar way to identify himself? Why would I say, listen to my voice? Or, look at my face. It hasn't changed that much. Or into my eyes. Well, naturally, I got to thinking about hands and feet during this reading. And for the most part, hands and feet are simply not the first thing we notice about each other. And yet they are very telling about who we are. Douglas Kandor understood that when he painted the official portrait of Eleanor Roosevelt. He portrayed her dynamism by using multiple images of her hands. The focal point of the portrait is Mrs. Roosevelt writing. And then grouped around it are three different vignettes. One, she's taking her rings off, preparing to do some hard work. And another pair she's knitting. I think we always heard stories of her knitting to send to the soldiers. I don't know whether it was socks or bandages or scarves. I don't know, but she's always knitting. Okay, so we've got her taking off her jewelry and knitting. And the third, she's cleaning her glasses so she might see the world more clearly. Now, you and I don't know Mrs. Roosevelt, didn't know her personally. But now we know something about her. That she was thoughtful when she took off her jewelry. That she wanted to do something to make the world better. That she wanted to see the world clearly. We know something about her by looking at what her hands had done. Once I was thinking about hands and Eleanor Roosevelt, it wasn't a far jump to my mother's hands. I truly think she was the only woman in Christendom that mourned the day the dress gloves went out of fashion. You remember when we had gloves to match everything? Beige gloves, blue gloves, black gloves, all kinds of gloves. My mother's hands were not beautiful, and she knew it. And she always wore gloves to cover them. You know that thin board that's in some dressers? That was my mother's glove drawer. She had gloves for every occasion and every outfit. Yet I loved her unlovely hands for all they did. They made beautiful clothes. I was a teenager and 6 feet tall, and the dress of my era was called, I forgot, I just said it this morning, had little tucks down front, a little collar, a villager dress. My mother made one to fit a 6 foot tall woman, and didn't look funny. My mother did that. She made all my formal gowns. My mother did that with her very ugly hands. She planted gardens. That's part of the reasons her hands look the way they did. But that was an envy of the neighborhood. She could grow anything. She had tomatoes, the first tomatoes and the last tomatoes of the summer. She had flowers. Her rose garden was well known. So she did wonderful things with her hands. She cooked delightful meals. And she wrote on chalkboards to teach fourth grade students the mysteries of science. Now you know a little bit about my mother and what she did. Now, I lived in San Francisco for a time, and I had a bout of flu out there. And you know what I wanted most in the world? It was not chicken soup. It was not even sherbet. It was my mother's hand on my fevered brow. I was sure, I was positive, I could have been healed if she were there, right there. And I know, to this day, I can identify my mother by her hands alone. They were unique, and they were wonderful. Now, as we get to know each other in the congregation, pastor and congregants, one of the privileges is breaking the Eucharistic bread and putting it in. And I got to know so much about my parishioners that way. And I don't know which hands I love the most. The ones that had some wear and tear on them, so that they had an idea of what the cost of this simple bread, this simple meal of bread and juice cost, or the little children's hands. I put them out there, and they said, taking it for granted, this is God's table, I'm God's child, give me my bread. I love all of the variety of hands. And what I do love about hands is they don't cough. They can't. We can usually exercise some control over our face so that when somebody looks at us, they see us the way we want them to see us. Usually we can do that. But our hands give us a look every time. They're nervous hands. Clenched hands, damp hands, soiled hands, they all testify to who we are. Now, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes and then go to sleep, okay? Because this is only a paragraph, so you just get to close your eyes for a little bit. And I want you to think of a pair of hands you know well. They can be your parents' hands. When you were a child, or when you were helping them get out of a chair, or get into the car, or go to the grocery store. Your partner's hand. Remember the jewel the first time you held the hand? Ooh, that was wonderful. Your partner's hand as you go through life. A child's hand, who wraps their whole hand around your two fingers and holds on for dear life. So you've got this firmly in your eyes on. What do these hands tell you? What are the marks on them? Is there a student bump where the pencil rests while you're writing? Are they paint splattered from various craft projects? Are they hard and calloused from doing manual labor? Are they soft and smooth from doing less physically demanding tasks? How would Douglas Chandler paint your person's? Would you know that person anywhere by their hands? Think about it. Would you know them anywhere by their hands? You can open your eyes now. Jesus said, look at my hands and my feet. And when the disciples did, they saw everything he had ever been to them. They saw the hands that had broken bread and blessed boiled fish. They saw hands that had reached out to the leper without holding back. They saw hands that pressed pads of blood against the blind man's eyes. They saw hands that took a dead girl by the hand so she could rise and walk. They saw hands that danced through the air while he was teaching, or wrote in the sand when he made a point. Hands that drove the money changers out of the temple. Those were all the things that Jesus' hands did. His hands washing the disciples' feet. That's what they saw. And his feet. The ones that had carried him hundreds of miles, taking the good news to all who were starving for it. In the homes of criminals and corrupt bureaucrats, who Jesus treated as if they were long lost men. Into the graveyard where the Gerasene demoniac lived like a wild dog among the dead, whom Jesus freed from his devil's grip. washed them with her tears and dried them with her hair. They remembered Mary sitting quietly, protected by Jesus, while Martha wailed at her to get up and work to do something. His hands and feet were wounded, all four. The hands that had joined Jesus with others, and the feet that had joined him to the earth, they had gaping holes in them. Sore, angry bruises that hurt the disciples to the flesh. But they had to work, because they had fled the cross earlier. They didn't know what they had. Look, Jesus said to them, when the danger was past, you can look at them now. He wanted them to know he had gone through the danger and not around it. So he told them not to look at his face, not into his eyes, but at his hands and feet, which told the truth about what had happened to him, which was the only proof he had that he was who he said he was. Now, some of us wish Jesus had come back all cleaned up and sparkling, but he didn't. He came back is something we could recognize in God, his hands and his feet, just like ours. So you know what his hands and feet said about Jesus. What do our hands and feet say about us? Where have they been? Who have they touched? How have they served? What have they performed? Jesus' parting words as he entrusted the disciples with the care of the world were, "You are witnesses to these things we have done." Those words echo across the centuries to us. We are witnesses because we have the scripture. And when the world looks around for the risen Christ, when they want to know what it means, it's us that they look at. The Church Universal and First United Methodist Church. It's not our pretty faces and not our sincere eyes, but at our hands and our feet. What have we done with them? Where have we gone with them? We are witnesses to all of these things because we are the body of Christ for the world. come up and down, he gets to stay seated for that. Stand in your mind, okay, but not with your knees. Got it? Okay, and it's our affirmation of faith is 883. It's from the Canadian Church.
Thank you.
fellowshipping the prayers of people, and you know, we can tell you, Lord have mercy,
your prayer.
All right. Let us go to humanity's prayer. Holy God, like a parent, you teach and challenge us to be the best we can be. You delight in us and offer us all that you have. Open our minds that we may hear what Jesus is telling us. Open our hearts to hear what the Spirit is saying. Help us discover and embrace the new possibilities that you lay before us. Inspire us to be the hands and feet of Jesus on earth, that we may do your work as Christ's body, here and now. Let us begin our work as we pray for each other. Lord, in your mercy, for the people of this congregation, Lord, in your mercy, those who suffer and those in trouble, Lord, in your mercy, the concerns of this local community, the homeless, the jobless, the hungry, Lord, in your mercy, the world, its people, leaders. The people of Syria. Lord, in your mercy. The Church Universal, its leaders, its members, its mission. Bishop Lewis, Jeanine Howard, Keith Ritchie, and the Commission on the Way Forward. Lord, in your mercy.
Yes.
As we join the communion of saints and praying the prayer that our Lord